Colossians 3, 1 through 4. It says, you read out loud with me, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, I pray right now that you would touch our hearts, Lord, that you would touch our minds, Lord, that you would touch our eyes, our ears, Lord, especially our spirit, Lord, that we might see, hear, know, and understand something new from the Word of God today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. God is up to some good stuff. And I feel like I'm a little short here. Okay. And I'm really excited about what God is doing. Even this name, the name Breakthrough. When we say, I've waited 40 years to say that. Welcome to Breakthrough. You know, and it's amazing though, when you think about a breakthrough is something that happens in our life, and we all want it to happen in our life. But it's when once you experience a breakthrough in your own life, you no longer want it only for yourself, you want it for others, okay? And so I always challenge even every leader that comes around, I always challenge them to, you want a breakthrough in your life? Amen? Who wants a breakthrough? We all want a breakthrough. But God always asks you to go through something first as a leader, right? You got to go through things first, and you go through it. And when I say breakthrough, when the Lord gave us that name, it's not a name that came easily. I want you to understand that. It was something that we've gone through some stuff, okay? We've been through some circumstances, and in every circumstance we found God to be faithful, amen? God is faithful. He's faithful on Mondays, he's faithful on Tuesdays, he's faithful on Wednesdays, he's faithful on Thursdays, he's faithful on Fridays, he's faithful on Saturdays, and he's especially faithful to this morning on Sunday morning, amen? And I'm excited about that. I'm excited about all the many things that God is doing in our lives. And even the little journals that you have, I want to challenge you to take a note today, okay? Even if it's just one word, if it's only one word, you just write down the word if, okay? That's the title of our message. If you only write down the word if, I would ask you to take that word with you this week, and I would ask you to meditate on that word this week. And if it's only when you find yourself in a situation, you say to yourself, if, okay? If that's all you say to yourself, you'll remember what the Word of God has spoken to your heart and to your life today, because God is a God that's speaking right now. Amen? It's not Pastor Everett that's speaking here today. Okay? It's the Holy Spirit. And we came here today because we long for a place of worship, a place where we can begin to worship God where there are no limits. Amen? The limits. The leader of this place, of this church, is Jesus Christ, amen? It's his kingdom, he's the leader, and he is the most high, amen? He is the most high leader. You can never find another leader better than that in your own life. If you long for a good leader in your life, look no further than Jesus Christ, because he will lead you, guide you, and direct you. He's the good shepherd, amen? He's the one that gave his life for the sheep. He gave his life for you, and that's something that maybe you can tell your neighbor, you know, Jesus gave his life for you. Yeah, say even for you. Come on, tell your neighbor, even for you. You know, turn to the other neighbor who is your second choice and say even for you. You know, is even for you too. You know, I'm not sure why. No, I'm just kidding. but you know, God is good. Amen. God is good, and He wants to do something. I want to challenge you also. You know, at the beginning of this message. Okay, I can talk and preach for hours. Okay. But we have the unusual opportunity this morning to set the culture of this place. When someone new walks through these doors, they're going to look at you, the leader, amen? You, the leader of this place, and they're going to say, how do I worship God, okay? And we, each of us, have to set the tone or the culture of this of worship. You know, it's not okay if maybe you worship, I don't know, I'm going to say it like this, but maybe you worship like this, okay? But but I'm going to ask you to at least smile when you worship, okay? To at least say hallelujah once in a while. At least raise your hand a little bit once in a while. Because God is bigger. He's bigger than my problem. He's bigger than my situation. He wants to transform me, amen? And if I'm unwilling to open myself up and be transformed, nothing will ever change, okay? If you want change in your life, let me say it like this. Everybody wants change, but nobody wants chains. You see what I said there? I changed the word just a little bit. It went from change to chains, okay? And unfortunately, if you're unwilling to change, you're in chains, okay? And so if we're unwilling to change, we'll always be chained. And God has come to set the captives free. Amen? Amen? That's a really powerful thing to think about just for a second. And I'm going to revisit that in a minute. I don't know why I gave it to you in the beginning. I love this verse. Of all the scriptures and all the Word of God, this first verse is so very powerful to me. It says the first few words, it says, "If ye then be." And I want to talk about this morning about just those few words, "if ye then be." And I want to go through that just for a minute with you. It says, "If ye then be." If usually is what something that has happened to me. You know, if you ever noticed that I would go to work today if I felt better. I would be nice if they were nice to me. I would be if this was happening. I would be happy if I had $1 million. I'd be happy if I had friends. I'd be happy if my kids were better. I'd be happy if my sister was nicer to me. I'd be happier if somebody would open the door for me at every store. I'd be happier if I had a front row parking spot everywhere I ever went, all right? And it was reserved. They had my name with a little plaque on it that said, "Reserved parking for Pastor Everett." If that would happen, I would be happy, right? Or I find it like this. It's either something that happened in our past, if that holds us back, or something that might happen in our future or might not happen in our future. Because we end up with we struggle between we struggle between the ifs in our life. The if this wouldn't have happened or if this could happen. We sit in the middle this morning, right in that little place where we don't know, can't go forward, but I can't go backwards, and I'm just stuck. You know, I don't know if you've ever felt that way, but if you ever have, amen, this sermon is for you this morning, because God no longer wants us to be stuck. And I want to explain that just a little bit further, but if the ifs in our life keep us from moving forward, they also keep us from going, we look backwards and we look forwards and we just sit there stuck. So if we find ourselves stuck because of the ifs in our life. And then there's this old English term called ye, okay? Turn to your neighbor and say ye. you are a ye, okay? And in this case, me is a ye. Okay, because in the context of this verse, I am the ye in this verse. Okay, so me is ye. Okay, say you can say it like that. Me is ye. You can write that down if you want, because it's really kind of a powerful thought when you think about it. But I think that somebody wrote it. It might have been Shakespeare. I don't know if it's not. I maybe butchered up Shakespeare a little bit. But he says, ye are what you are. Okay, it wasn't Shakespeare that said that. Ye are what you are. It sounded like a pirate. Ye are what you are, since they tell me. Amen. The ye or the me in me right now, the one that stands before you right now, is the present now. I'm present now, and that's who the Apostle Paul is writing this text to. He says, the present now person, the one who stands before me today, the ye and you. We all stand here this morning. I stand here this morning, a stack of many decisions that led me to this place where I stand this morning, but I stand here a stack of decisions. Each of you sit here this morning, a stack of decisions. The decisions that you have made in your life have brought you to this place where you stand or sit or walk or drive or whatever it is you're doing in your life. You are a compilation, okay? You are a book that has been written, and each decision has led you to this place. this place where you stand, the present now moment where you are, how you feel, how you act, how you treat others. All of those things are part of the now that you are, the he or the me that stands or sits here this morning. We are a stack of decisions, okay? That sits here. We sit here with a stack of decisions. How many of you know that you can't change any of those right now? There's not a thing you can do to change anything that's ever happened in your past. Nothing will ever change any of that. It's done. It's over with. We are powerless. Amen? Yeah, I think it's really important to understand that. I stand in the mirror sometimes. Actually, I do it every day. I stand in front of the mirror and I say to myself, after I say you're so gorgeous and good looking and I love your eyes and man, you're smart and there's just nobody stronger than you. There's nobody better than you. You're the greatest speaker of all time. There's people have been born and people have died, and there's never been another person exactly like you, because I am original. I am a perfect composition of what God wanted for this time, for this moment, for this place. Amen. I can't get away from that. I can't run away from it. I can't hide from it. I need to bear that out, bear that truth out in front of the mirror. Amen. It's not until I understand who God made me to be that I can actually go and do what He has really called me to do. Amen. And so, the present now, this moment. Amen. And I think we got to come to a place where we understand. We must admit that we can't blame God. Come on. Many of us get mad at God. We try to blame God for our this present moment because it's because of you, God. I was trying to do this, and it's your fault, you know. And we get mad at God. We close our heart down, and the very one that loves you the most, that one that can do the most to change your life and your attitude and your circumstances, is the one we get mad at this morning. So I want to ask you this morning: are you willing to say, God, I forgive you? Come on. It's not your fault that I'm here, amen, in this moment. It's not your fault. My attitude is not your fault, God, okay? And because God is a God of love, amen? God of love. He longs to take us somewhere good, somewhere beautiful. And if you understand the heartbeat of God, He's always looking to do what is good and right and just and best for us, amen? It may not always feel good, all right, when mom says no or dad says no. Or God says no. Come on. But we must be willing to submit to that. Okay? What God is doing in me. With my if, with my ye, my me, my moment right now, my present moment. And He's longing to do something awesome then. Okay? Then. Amen? So let's talk about then for a second. Isn't it interesting that this verse deals with my past, it deals with my present, and it deals with my future. Just in three words, it says, if ye then, right? If ye then, dealing with my past, my present, and my future. So then we look at the fact that my then, right, is a projection of who I am now, amen? Because what happened in my past has brought me to this place where I am now, and all of those things bring me to a place where I begin to project forward into my future, future then, okay, that something that will happen. I begin to project forward. These two ingredients are directing my future. Come on, think about it. If I allow my past and my present feelings to touch my heart, it will change my future, okay? Amen. Can I get an amen? That's really good. It's kind of deep, but I want you to think about it a little bit because are you projecting your future? Are you directing your future? That's why I guess the question. Are you allowing the ingredients of your life to direct your future? Because if you're allowing those two things to direct your future, guess what? Guess what your future is going to look like? Just take a wild guess. Anybody got an idea? I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to look just like it does right now, and maybe even a little bit worse, because you're not qualified to direct your future. You're not capable. You don't have the understanding of what's going to happen tomorrow. Amen. You're not God. Amen. And it's important for you to come to a place where you understand that. If ye then, my past, my present, and I'm not going to project. Okay, my future. I'm not going to direct my future. Amen. Amen. Because my experience, think about this. My experience is based on something that I went through and how I felt at that moment. and it's based on a feeling, it's based on a friend, it's based on a whatever, it's based on whatever things those are that make up my being right now, and my experience is going to lie to me, okay? Because if I say, okay, because of my experience, nothing good is ever going to happen in life, okay? And I get this negative attitude, I walk around, and every time I see something that is good, maybe even God places it in front of me, and I look at that moment and that opportunity, I'll say it's not any good. That's not God. Oh no, God is not there. God is not working. God is not directing. God, and I end up stuck right where I am. Amen. I end up chained. Woo. We are speaking and we are creating our futures by what we say. It's very powerful when you think about that. We have a thing we do in church, okay? And it's called, I'll say a number like 828, okay? And if you hang around long enough, 828 automatically means Romans 8, verse 28. And it says, and we know, who knows? We know that all things work together for good to those that love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. How many of us are called here this morning? All of us are called. And we know, because come on, that's a congregation thing. And we know, okay? We know that all things work together for good. That God is working all things together for good. That God is directing and guiding steps to people that we don't even know. People that are listening to us even right now on whatever, YouTube or wherever we are, or online. So we're going to go to Twitter. We're going to go to all over the place. It doesn't really matter where we're going, but somebody is listening, okay? Right now, that's not in this room. So we see what's in this room and we go, my goodness, it's not very many people here. I'm going to tell you, there's people behind that camera there that are listening that need the Word of God. They need to hear what we're doing. They need to understand what the God that we serve. They need to know that we're worshiping Him, okay? And that He's worthy of our worship. In Rockford, Illinois, in an old cabin somewhere in the backwoods somewhere. But God is doing something powerful even here, even now. Amen? Yes. Amen? And then we go a little further, because we say 828, we know it means Romans 828, but if I say to you 1010, okay, that means also Romans chapter 10, verse 10, which says, with the heart we believe unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is faith. So when we begin to speak, right, what is in your heart is already coming out. So if you hang around somebody long enough, you're going to begin to hear what is in their heart. And you say to them, show me your heart. You don't have to say that, show me your heart. You just have to listen with your ear. And pretty soon you're going to know what their heart is, okay? Because what's inside of them is going to come out of them. It always happens. Always will happen. It happens to me. Happens to you. And we're not aware of it most of the time. But what's in our heart comes out. And because it comes right out through the mouth. The mouth gate, okay, is a direct connection to your heart, okay? And so if you listen long enough, you would begin to understand that we are speaking or projecting our future, okay? We begin to create a future based on our experience, based on what happened, the ifs, and who we are. We begin to understand. But I'm going to say that what we need to get to, what we need to understand. Okay, I'm trying to talk to your brain just for a second. What I'm trying to get you to understand is you're not that smart. Okay, I say it just like that. You can write that down. I'm not that smart. Okay, because you're really not that smart. And you know what? Pastor Everett isn't that smart either. But I need to trust God, okay? I need to trust Him that His Word is true, that what He says to us will happen. What He says to us in the Word, okay? It will go into our life. It will change us. It will make us somebody we are not now, okay? In 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17, it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. All things become new. So who wants something new? Come on, in your life. Somebody wants something new in your life? Everybody wants something new in their life. And you're not going to receive newness in your life unless you let go of oldness, okay? Come on. Old, stubborn things sometimes. We got to let go of things. Amen? God is, think about this. God is creative. The moment that He spoke in Genesis chapter 1, He said, let there be light. What happened? Light happened, okay? There wasn't light before. God created light from nothing. God created light from nothing, okay? And that same God speaking into our life right now is creating something from nothing. Come on. And it's not until we say to ourselves, I am nothing, God. What my experience has told me, what my gift has told me, who I am right now at this moment, has to change. Because God is able to create something more powerful, more beautiful, more awesome, more great than any of us could ever imagine, or any of us could ever put together. He's about changing and transforming and making new and building up and growing us. Amen? Us. We are the church. We are the church. You're the church. Point to your neighbor and just tell them, you're the church. And you're the one that God called. Now, come on. You're the one that God had died for. And He's the one that brought you to this moment. He longs to create in you something powerful. Amen? And then, so we're at if ye, then be. Okay? I want to do this be. I want to talk about be just for a second. Be. If I could stand here right now in this moment, and I could say to you, to myself, if I could stand in the mirror right now, okay, let's go to my bathroom. I'm going to stand in front of the mirror. And if I could stand in front of the mirror, and I could tell myself something in this moment, 10 years from now, that I'll be 10 years later down the road, if I could say to myself something right now, to say to my 10-year-old later self, what would it be? I want you to think about this. What could be? What should be? Who do you want to be? Because if I allow my current trajectory to continue, what will I be then? See? Then. But what does God want me to be? There's two different courses there. To be or not to be. That was by Shakespeare. The other one, that wasn't Shakespeare. But what do you want to be in your life? Come on. Think about it. What do you want to be? What do you want to be? You see, and to me, I'm going to answer that question for me. The ye and me, okay? The question when I answer that question, I'm going to tell myself, my future self, I want you to be who God created you to be. Amen? And I'm going to tell you right now, that only comes from obedience and submission to the will of God in your life. Amen? He longs to do something with your life. Amen? You're precious and you're awesome, and God is building you up, and God is teaching you and growing you and making you become something more than you could ever be on your own. Amen? To be. Now, I if you hear me talk much, you're going to hear me say this a lot lately, but I remember Elijah standing in front of the children of Israel, and I feel a little bit like that this morning. And he said to the children of Israel something really powerful. He said, how long will you stop? How long will you halt between two opinions? And I'm going to ask you right now, how long will you stop letting God do what He wants to do so that you can be who He wants you to be? Come on. How long will you stop? And I'm going to tell you right now, I am committed. I am committed to reading the Word of God. I am committed to prayer. I have been praying. I've been skipping meals, okay? I've been doing things that I have never done before because I want to see God do something that He's never done before. Amen? And I'm excited, amen, about not stopping. Okay? Amen? Is that okay? Matter of fact, I think we should get a stop sign. But to remind us, and maybe you need to draw one or take a picture of one, but you should put it on your mirror, put it on your refrigerator. Some of us need it on our refrigerator more than others, but it says stop. You know, it's like, stop, baby. But we need to stop. Stop stopping. Stop stopping what God wants to do in your life. Stop letting the if in my life. Stop letting the experiences of my past, the how I feel, the moment of desperation, the moment of anger, all of those things. Stop letting them stop you. Become who God wants you to be. Amen? Amen. 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 Woo. That's only the first four words. Amen. So I want to go through just a little more. I'm not going to talk for 4 hours. I could, but I won't. I want to talk for just a few more moments, folks. I know at some point you get tired of listening to me. But let me talk about risen, okay? It's important that we understand as a Christian, okay, as a follower of Jesus Christ, that it says, if ye then be risen. Think about that. Because we stack up what we just talked about, and we say, if ye then, okay, my future, my past, my present, everything, if ye then be risen. Then it says something really powerful. It says, risen with Christ. Okay, so then we have to go, okay, did Christ rise? Come on, did he rise? And if he did rise, where did he go? Okay, where is Jesus at right now? Well, he's sitting at the right hand of the Father, amen? Why is he sitting at the right hand of the Father? Because that's the strong arm, that's the power of God, amen? He sits there at the right hand, but he also sits somewhere else. Where is he at? He's here in my heart, amen? He's here in my heart. So I have a connection as a Christian with a risen Savior, okay? I have a connection with a Savior that not only was born of a virgin, okay? Grew up, got tired, got dirty, went through all the struggles of life, was crucified on a cross for me. They put a crown of thorns in his, and he gave his life. And he said, it is finished. He was buried, okay? He rose the third day, amen? He was seen of above 500 witnesses, amen? And he rose to heaven and has sat down at the right hand of the Father, amen? If he then be risen with Christ. Come on, what does that mean? That means some had to die, okay? Some had to die. Not only did Jesus have to die, but something in my life had to die, amen? That means I had to give up my life. Is it okay for Jesus to give up his life and not okay for us to give up our life? Or is it okay? Is it just a one-way street? No. It says, if I was risen with Christ, okay? That means that something in me had to die, amen? I had to lay down something of my own so that I don't think Jesus is happy if I just give him, you know, my big toe, my right leg, okay, half my brain, a quarter of my heart, half my pocketbook, you know? He's not happy with all of those things. He wants all of you, amen? He wants all of you, and he wants you to come to a place in your life where you're willing to lay your life down, really lay it down, and really say, God, I'm going to give you all of my life. I'm going to give you all that I am so that I can become who you want me to be. Amen? If he then be risen with Christ. And it says something really powerful after that. It says, can I give you a contradiction? Let me just do this. I'm going to show you two verses. In John 3, verse 19, it says, and this is the condemnation. Right? This is the condemnation that light has come into the world and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. Here's a contradiction. In Romans 8:1 it says, there is therefore now no condemnation. Come on, here's the difference. The one verse says, men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. Right? In the other verse it says, there is no therefore now no condemnation to those that are in Christ. Did you see the contradiction? See, if I don't have any condemnation because I am in Christ, right? Because I have laid my life down, amen? And then he goes on to say, the law of the spirit of life in Christ has made me free from the law of sin and death. In other words, I walk by a different law. Come on. As a Christian, we walk by a different law. I no longer walk by the laws of the land, of the United States of America or the globe or any of that thing. Matter of fact, if I would begin to operate, okay, in the law of the spirit of life, which is found in Christ Jesus, I have separated myself and I'm allowing God, the only God that has ever been or ever will be, that intervenes in the heart and the life of men, is the one we serve here this morning. That's the one we speak of. That's the one, the God of the Bible, the God of the words of the page of the Bible that jump off that page and speak into my life. If I would allow the creative God from heaven on high, from my heart, to begin to speak into my life, what could happen? What could happen? I'm going to tell you right now, anything can happen. Anything can happen. Because I believe. Because I am now with Jesus Christ, right? Because I have risen with him. Amen? I have risen with him. Come on. Let me just give you a couple more things and I'm going to be done. But I want to tell you something else. I want to go to the word seek, okay? If ye then be risen with Christ, seek, okay? Because if I could just talk for a moment about the word seek, you know, has anybody ever played hide and seek before? Somebody's played it before. I mean, who's good at it? I mean, who's still looking for somebody? My sister, I don't know what happened to her. She's just gone somewhere. I don't know where she went. I know, I didn't see her in 23 years. I don't know where she is. What are you looking for right now, though? Come on. What are you looking for right now? Okay? Because often in our life, we find people, they come into our life, and I had a meeting with somebody this week, and it was an unexpected meeting. I wasn't expecting to meet with them. And I went to their office, and I began to talk to them. And you know what I found out? I wasn't there to meet them. Okay? It was a divine meeting. It was a God thing. Because right in the middle of two separate motivations, okay? My motivation was not even for whatever. It was just whatever, you know? I felt like I should go there. I felt like God wanted me to go there. I went there and it was like whatever, okay? I wasn't looking for money. I wasn't looking for influence. I wasn't looking for nothing. I was just being obedient to what I felt like God had called me to do. Amen? I stepped in through the doors, and there in that moment, there was motivation on the other side. But God had a purpose. Amen? And I would challenge you, if you would be willing to seek him, to seek God, to seek what he wants, to test it, okay? To try it out, to say, I'm going to just try it out, God. I'm going to give you this day. I'm going to worship you. I'm going to give you what I got. I'm going to give you all I am today. That you will begin to find that I am, actually, you know what challenged me? Is as I begin to seek the things of God, I find that my motivation, I begin to analyze my motivation, that I've begun writing down, you know, some of the things that I'm motivated by, or even think about, just bring it back to consciousness. What am I really seeking in this moment? And you know what's scary is you find out that your motivation, I mean, I'm talking about you now, your motivation is not that good, okay? Most of us have wrong motivations, okay? I know I do. I just said you because I want to divert the attention off of me, but the truth is, it is me too. My motivations are not always right. But I'm going to ask you to really underline that word and say, what am I seeking? Okay? I want to show you something. In Matthew 7, verse 7 and 8, it says, you know this verse. It says, ask and it shall be given to you. It shall be given to you, it says. Seek and ye shall find. Right? Knock and it shall be opened. And then right away, Jesus repeats himself. He repeats himself, and he says in verse 8, but he changes the words a little bit. He says, for everyone that asketh, see the difference? He's asking you to ask, but he's saying, are you asketh? Okay, asketh. I'm going to look the old English on you today. Okay, but are you asking? What are you asking for? You see, because that's what happens. If we're asking, God is going to give it to you. If you're asking, he says, you're going to receive it. You're going to receive it, right? If you ask it, you'll receive it. And he that seeketh, right? He said, seek, and you will find, right? He said, he that seeketh, findeth. And then he goes on to say, and him that knocketh, right? He said, the verse above, he said, him that knocketh, it shall be opened. But it's really going, it reminds me of a verse. I'm just going there. I give you a verse. It reminds me of a verse in James. It says, James 1, verse 22, be ye doers of the word. Often, we're not doing what God is already saying in our life. And if we're not doing, you're never going to get what you really need in your life, what you really want in your life. Are you knocking? Really? Are you? Or are you motivated by something else? Come on. Seek ye. We set our, and it goes on not say our affection, but I want to be done. I want to be done. I want to wrap this up. I want to show you something. I want to show you something. I need three volunteers. Who wants to come up here? Come on up. Anybody can come up. Come on up. Just three of you. I want to show you something. I want to show you something. Just three volunteers. Who else we got? One more? Can do it? Okay. This is really powerful. I just want to show you something. Actually, this is not even a revelation from me, okay? This is Joanne and I were in prayer, okay? And the Lord showed this to me. But it confirmed a couple of verses. So I want to read just to preface this. I want to show you something. It says in Matthew 18, it says, verse 19 says, if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything you ask, you'll have it, okay? And then we go to John 4. It says God is a spirit, right? John 4, chapter 4, verse 24, God is a spirit, they worship him as worshiping the spirit and truth. And then in Exodus 15, verse 6, there's more verses on the right hand, but I want to show you, it says, thy right hand, O Lord, has become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, that dash in pieces the enemy. Okay? And so everybody hold up your right hand. Okay? Hold up your right hand. Right? Your right hand represents power, okay? And that's why when we go up to meet somebody, we always shake their hand. Right? Right? We always shake our hands. And that's because I'm saying I'm friendly with your power, okay? In other words, you got my power, I got your power, we agree, right? Okay? There's something really powerful about the word agree, though, okay? Because if you translate this wrong, it would say, if two of us have agreed, right, as touching anything, okay? So if two of us have agreed, you see that there's a difference, because if we've agreed with something, that means our motivation, right, is for greed, okay? In other words, what we're going to gain because of our friendship, right? Our power has come together so that we can receive something that we're motivated for, right? Whatever that is, okay? It might be a business, it might be money, it might be influence, it might be all of those things. But that's not what the verse says. The verse says, if two or more would agree, right? So we did it like this. There, if you stand right here, Emily, okay? Put your hand up, put your right hand up, okay? Okay? How many right hands do we have? Here. I have a right hand and she has a right hand, right? One each. Okay? But if you notice, if we agree, okay, look at this. If we agree as touching anything, so here's what happens. Okay. It's what happens. Okay?
Here's
the
mouth. Oh yeah.
So if my right hand touches her left hand, right, and we agree as touching anything, how many right hands are there? There's still two, right? But it's really one, right? The power goes in. Look, I'm going to push with my right, you push with your right. Okay, I'm overemphasizing. Okay, see what's happening? It becomes a circle, right? It becomes a difference. Now, if two or three of them, you guys do it now. Do it all together. Yeah. Okay. Now, how big can the circle get? If it can get as big as it needs to be, but where's the power go? It keeps going through, right? There's not an end to the power. If two or more would agree as touching anything, they'll have what it said. But what they've done is they suspended the greed, though, right? They're no longer saying, I want what I want, or wanting what God wants, right? And so what they've done is opened a portal. I'm going to tell you this. They've opened a portal for heaven to come to earth, okay? And so if God is going to change something, right, who wants to be inside the circle? You see what I'm saying? If you want open heavens, we must agree, okay, that we're going to trust God and we're going to allow the power of God to continue to flow through us, right? Through us. Yes. In agreement. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Can we give God some praise? Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you can stand with me, I'm going to dismiss you at this moment, but I want to challenge you guys. I want to challenge you. The number one thing I want to challenge you with is the fact that we must pray. We must seek God. Amen? We must worship Him. Okay? I worship God in the morning, I worship Him at night, I worship Him all the time. I'm trying to worship Him because I want what He wants. And I'm going to ask you today to come in agreement with me, okay? Not for greed, not for fame, not for fortune, okay? Not for anything other than whatever God wants, okay? I'm going to ask you just to ask God, what is it that you want me to do? What can I do today so that I can be who you want me to be? Amen? You know, we all got the ifs, the yees, and the thens. And we also have a me that's coming before us. Whatever it's going to be, amen? I want it to be all that God wants. Amen? Not a thing beyond, not a thing aside from, but I want it to be. Amen? Let it be, Lord, in me. Let it be in me, Lord. You know what's really powerful about the word be? Yes. I always like to add the word love to it. Because if I'm going to be loved by God, I must understand that I am also loved by God. Amen? And if God is a God of love, and He is, then He would love, honestly, He would love to change your life. He would love to transform you. He would love to transform the person that you see in the mirror, and the person that you talk to every day, the one that talks to you that has been leading and guiding you, maybe in the wrong directions, okay? He would long to transform that powerful voice inside of you to be something special in this earth. Oh, earth, hear the word of the Lord. Amen? God has spoken today. When God speaks, He deserves a response from us. Amen? And you are the one that must respond. Because the word of God has gone out, and it will not return void. It will always bear fruit in each of our lives. Every single time. Every word. Every dot. The word says every little dot, every little period, every little asterisk, every little comma, every little pronunciation point, every little quotation, every little thing. God is longing to do something. Amen? Amen. So I want to ask you today, in the presence of the Lord, because I feel His presence here right now, I know that God is doing something. Amen? And I long for Him to do something in my life. Amen? Today? And it's something in your life today. Amen? So I'm going to ask you, Lord, to just to pray a little prayer. It's a powerful prayer. Hold up your right hand. Lord, we just ask right now that you would touch us, that you would change us, that we would become who you have called us to be in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. God is good, amen. God is good. I'm so excited today about what He's doing. Anybody has a need, you know, we love to pray with you. Brother Al, come and help pray. And if you have needs, we love to pray with you. Otherwise, we're excited about what God is doing. And just be praying. There's a lot of opportunities going on right now. Things that nobody knows about. Okay? And just be excited about that. Talk to your neighbors. Talk to your friends. Okay? Invite them to a little bitty lodge. The little woods, okay? And give them good directions, okay? Meet them, pick them up, drive them here, it doesn't matter. There's an old saying, and I believe it's very true. If a church is alive, it's worth the drive. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And I believe that the Spirit of God is in this place. Amen. Amen. I know he has that in here, but amen on that one. Amen. Okay.
Amen.